clinical sessions as scheduled.
Hello.
This picture is showing the discussion. As I said, the helmet. Why this helmet came into the picture? We first using Wi-Fi. The requirement, the data rate, which is not possible to handle by LTE. We know that LTE is best for us because it is very reliable. There is very less data loss. It is in terms of the radio range, it's managed I think to if I'm not wrong, 200 more than. Of course, it is compared to wireless technology to manage the more radio range and high speed data rate more than 200 Mbps. That's the requirement of LTE Advanced. In spite of all these, why we have to clock Wi-Fi with LTE? Because as per the requirement, this LTE is the licensed version. We need to license the spectrum, which is limited. Which is, we can't extend as per our requirement. If our demand is increasing the exponential rate, we will increase the supply in that. We can't. We have some bump in there. So how to solve our day-to-day life, I mean, as per the population requirement? So why not to use the Wi-Fi? Where the Wi-Fi is the spectrum, I mean the range we are using, the frequency we are using in Wi-Fi, which is unlicensed. So why not to clock this licensed version with unlicensed version and solve the problem? So that's the headline topic came into the picture, clock together. Second point, as I mentioned, in the radio level, what it means the radio level, that I will come just right now. If I am discussing this picture, the data is coming with I think not well operating it or it is not working somehow. A video server is there. From video server to internet, the data is going in one, the router. These are the two routers. Either it is follow on cellular network from the server to the end of user. This is the end user. So end user, either it go to follow the cellular network or it follow the Wi-Fi network. That's the present scenario. They how to do that? They are using the multipath TCP. So multipath TCP, either from the server you follow the cellular or network. I'm pointing this line because till now this is the strategy. And my proposal, instead of dividing from the, and this division will happen at the user end. Before divide to the two channel from the user, put an integrated box there and they will divide. So I come to again that point. Well, this is the multipath that recent paper in 2016. This is a very good paper we published. My work on based on the extension of this work. What they are doing, they are using the MPTCP of the video transmission. Here, whatever we saw, that is in detail. That one is going through the IP address, which is cellular by wireless network and by each device. The device we are using now, there is both radio frequencies there, right? We can use LTE cellular or we can activate Wi-Fi. Both we can activate it. But the data is not coming together. It is either it will be cellular or it will be Wi-Fi. So that's the motivation of the work. Considering the LTE and Wi-Fi are two different channels, why not to consider if it is a headnet, consider both are together and the user will receive the data on the both ends. So that's the motivation in using, right now they are using multiple. As the single radio network bandwidth is insufficient at the end user side, therefore the aggregation of these two radio networks at the radio level, instead of the division at the transport that TCP layer is using, I'm going to the division at the IP layer. We propose an optimal algorithm to efficient use of these two radio technology. So based on that, this is the proposal that high aggregation.
represented forms and images. And the last one, cube, use an 8x8 line represented for C an image and letter and number. This prototype uses 512 threads and is developed to improve the level of representation. And orders. N3NAN15 integrated circuit with keeping the representation stored in a digital memory and then represent in the light cube prototype. The LM circuit integrated as described at a dot or bar graph with 18 pins in a package. This circuit is able to handle directly 10 LEDs in a dot or a bar mode. In other words, this circuit allow to work with 10 outputs between minus 27 to 0 decibels sounds with 10 steps. This circuit is a specific.
So log distance is actually calculated from. So from image processing, we can know the wheel is actually located opposite to the robot. So this distance is actually calculated using another formula. For the formula, this D is required. D is log distance, and so this is H, normal diameter. So that is actually main part to calculate magnitude and length. This is the formula to. After calculating log distance, we can find the location of GPS location of this wheel using this formula. CL and CO are the two locations, longitude and magnitude. So after calculating our GPS locations, so we send that location to our UGV system. So UGV system actually, I said it's using two point navigation, so first point and the other point. So from initial point, it calculates bearing angle by itself. So this is to data from image processing, and it calculates bearing angle by itself. That's what angle it should move from this exact point. So here it is shown like this. This is by vehicle center line, this destination. It moves like this. As well, if it faces some obstacle, means it creates a new path line, and it creates a new bearing angle to move away from the obstacle and it goes. Okay, this is our we have done a system to start from area introduction and to wheel cutting. Our prototype is it's done actually tested from image processing from aerial vehicle to UGV. Here we have faced some problems when developing the road actually is not good to move a UGV. So we faced a lot of problems while documenting our robot. So that has to be done with futuristic equipment like suspension systems. So that is a future idea. This aerial location also, it has to be improved with the machine learning techniques, so it actually finds more precise beats than normal. And future scope is like more powerful engine to cut a big trees. Now we are using actually, we can cut a tree of 1 meter height. So future we can cut even this big trees like 3 meters, 5 meter height, which is actually a big problem. You know, these trees create a big problem of it's actually moisture content of air as well as the root. This is actually required to cut a big trees initially. Adding necessary supporting elements like stem grinder, chipper. So, to adapt this technology for a large scale implementation, now we are developing with one robot and one aerial vehicle. So, future we can go with one aerial vehicle can send signals to multiple UGVs automatically. So by single aerial vehicle, we can easily eradicate a big land space. As Balaji explained, 25% of vegetation in Tamil Nadu is actually affecting this leaf system, which is actually a huge amount. As well as this tree can produce.
In 2016, they have also used binding factory. Another pre-processing technique we have used for
initiated data into Leica in the previous, like in the previous I have used divided into 28 pixels, sorry, that is mean the initiated answer. Then the morphological creation parts it is present in the form of physics. Then it is very difficult to understand for the machine what is that doing. So I have I am using thing as a 3D algorithm to convert the this easily into this easily. These are the skeletal input. And then dilation. This is the thing algorithm. The result of the dilation operation is this. If there is any hole or block present in the machine, then the dilation operation fills that hole. So I am using dilation operation in that purpose. Then this is the hole. So this is filled by dilation. Classification generally includes step training and testing. That's training here. So neural network I am using as a classifier with a graph propagation algorithm. In other graph propagation algorithm, I am using scale continuous gradient method. So these are the layers. So input known. I convert each easy into 28 cross 28 pixels of each layer. So there are total 784 input. 784 input node and there total output. Two minutes.
But finish in 2 minutes. Please. Only because you have spent a lot of time on literature review.
So these are the like the input node. In order to calculate the output and X1 node, I compute W1 into this M plus biasing factor under phi j. Biasing factor is
asymmetric data rates. These are the contents of my slide. First, I will present introduction, motivation, then system and channel model, then performance analysis in which I will explain overall outage probability evaluation, then asymptotic outage behavior, then I will explain what is optimal relocation. Basically, the basic purpose of the spatial diversity is needed. So, to achieve this rapid diversity, the very popular technique is MIMO, but it does not the means achieve the diversity in distributed manner. So, to achieve the diversity in distributed manner, a cooperative relaying is used from which we can achieve the cooperative diversity. So, this is the basic model of two-way relaying. In any relay model, there is three nodes are there. This is the sender, this is relay, and this is the receiver. Suppose if we are talking about the one-way relay, then the sender will send the information to the relay only. But the problem with the one-way relay is that it is the less spectrally efficient. So the two-way relay has been introduced. So in two-way relay, means this will be acted as a sender and this also will be acted as a sender. So both the terminal
corresponding to that keyword, that segment of the encrypted data, he will return it to the user. So it is efficient from the previous approach, but this is limited to a single user. A single user stores his data over the cloud and retrieves the segments of the data of that encrypted text. But now there is the concept of public key encryption with keyword search. In this is applicable. Now the motivation is that it becomes very burden over the cloud is increased. He is storing the files as well as he is having file query management also, keyword query management also. Manager. what we have done, I just introduced another engaging element, which is the cloud. You have the receivers. Now, the sender stores this encrypted file along with the set of viewers and the cloud. But whenever the receiver has to receive the file from the cloud, corresponding to
So the thing is, in vector quantization, we use the vector quantizer, the image blocks. But here, since all the chunks are, like you can see, all the blocks are uniformly shared, this is redundant, that you need not give the same blocks so many times to the vector quantizer. So what we can do is, we can merge these blocks into a single block, and link that single block to the vector quantizer. For example, let me say, if m block represent each log, we just need log k to the base 2 divided by m bits. So this way, the bit rate can be reduced for the reconstructed image. But since the bit rate can be reduced, this is not the end, because you even have to take into account the distortion that is used because of the decrease in the bit rate. So, a small research work which has been done in the past. Each Bayesian version, they introduced a variable log size image sorting technique. So they have used this quartic segmentation. So in this quartic segmentation, now we get another quantization method called slab size vector quantization. So as in previous, we said vector quantization means multiple portals. Method uses multiple portals. What this does is divide the image blocks into classes, and for each class it has a code book.
This is enabled if it's deep with HCFT is marked with at least WPT token. Its status also expressed by the ARC expression. So if the ARC expression is satisfied, then only this transmission can be fired. So it can either be fired or not fired, depends on the region. So firing the red color token. Black color token here represents yellow token, and the red color token here represents the fuzzy token. So if a place consisting of black color token, that means there is no any fuzzy token presence, or the place is heavy. And if overall lake there is no any red color token presence, and then both systems are sentient is heavy. So if red color, then there is something fuzzy. So if there is a token, red token present in a place, then that can be spread into other places, and the whole system maybe get failure after if it gets propagated. So we have utilized five lack of independent actually to it's a good tool to model the system for performance modeling and actually it's graph music by So we are developing online shopping systems in the example domain to demonstrate our efforts, and we have utilized search functions as well. So this is the basic basic example domain of our system, so that only explains the system structure of domain online shopping. So for notation, this example is difficult to create in text unit, so we have used something to represent it in a text unit form. So if you don't have place of item order service, and G1 that place of name ranging text service, and P0 as means there are only heavy token present in place P0. P0 as means it will have a quality token present in it. And then P0 is coming to P0 that gets fired, and if it gets fired, then the token comes from P0 to P1. So this is the particular representation of our example domain. So this is forward incidence. Forward incidence means what happens when a transition is fired. So this is the matrix. So here, if P0 gets fired, then we go into
we have to minimize the outage probability. So from 0 to 1 means the zero, that is relocation from 0 to 1, we have to choose the best relocation so that the outage probability should be minimum. So for this, for case 1, case 2 and case 3, we have first derivated the outage probability expression, asymptotic outage probability expression twice, and we found that this is the positive. So taking the first derivative, power is terminal R, power is VR. So all the terminal power is equal to PT by 3, total power divided by 3. So this is the result for the case 1 and case 2. From this result, I can see that the means my numerical results matches perfectly with the simulation result, and I can also see that the if there is a general expression error present in the system, then the my diversity order reduces to zero, means there is no diversity. But if the channel is perfect for this case and this case, the we can get the diversity of minimum of Na comma K, similarly for the case 2. For the case 3, when the both are symmetrical data, the again the diversity, this is the optimal relay location, this is the position of the relay, and this is the overall outage probability. So for this I have considered that the total number of antenna N is equal to 2, K is equal to 1, and the result has been calculated for the SNR is equal to 20 dB. So if number of antenna N is equal to 1 and the number of user K is equal to 2, so if I talk about the TA to R terminal and R to TB terminals, then definitely TA to R terminal is better because here number of antenna is 2. So R to TB terminal is worse. So the relay position will be shifted toward the worst position. So here we can see that the in all the cases the relay position is shifted towards the TB K terminal. So in summary, we have calculated the overall outage probability and considered the asymmetricity and channel estimation error. We have also derived the asymptotic outage probability, and also we have calculated the optimal relocation. Sir, means it means that the rate is changing, then the how outage probability will be had.
So is it rate gauge parameter, not more than that?
Yes sir.
Okay.
Yes sir.
So if I visualize there, then rate is R plus minus delta or whatever those values are there.
Yes sir.
Those kind of
yes sir.
Or they are discrete changes are there in rate?
No sir.
One question. What has rate to do with the outage problem?
Sir, if rate will change, then means the system will behave differently.
we have seen that there has been a lot of the nature of nuclear families. So there is many people, elderly people who are left at home alone, but they need assistance. So what do we do for that? We incorporate video server assistance in the homes, so they can be notified, the kids can be notified as and when there may be any problem with them, like fall or fainting or chest pain, which can lead to heart attack. So they have to be diagnosed at the correct time. Moving on to the point of safe. To avoid break-ins and robbery, there is a suspicious activity which occurs nearly every time, that is loitering. Especially during nights, if we have systems incorporated in our homes that detect loitering, we can prevent robbery and also break-ins. In case of bank robbery, we can use object detection, because object detection systems will be fed with images of guns or knives or similar dangerous weapons, and this can be used to alert the security and the nearby police stations. All in all, when it comes to living, we aim towards smart homes. Smart homes have ambient assisted living. Ambient assisted living has a lot of sensors incorporated all over the house that you can see. There are light sensors, motion sensors, door sensors, pressure sensors, and vibration sensors. For example, if the system detects that a person is, the pressure sensors near the bed are active for an unusual, more time of the day, that means that the person is sick. So it will analyze this and produce the result that the person is sick, the person needs help. And even the door sensors can be used to prevent break-in. Like, we can detect if a break-in occurs. And also, another improvement in this can be by incorporating intelligent video surveillance systems, so that we can actually determine if there is any abnormal activity, if the person faints, and if there is no one at home. These sensors won't be much useful in that case. So we need video surveillance. The motivation for my research work is that, as per statistics, in 2012 there have been 24,190 fatal and 3.2 million non-fatal injuries just due to fall. And this has led to a huge amount that has been invested into the recovery, and it has increased from $646.8 million to $698.8 million from 2012 to 2015. This means a handsome amount of capital has been invested, but it can be largely reduced if it is detected at the right point by using smart surveillance systems. Moving on to the key contributions of my research work. The first is average energy silhouette novel descriptor, which is designed for algorithm detection and recognition of abnormal human activity. And we have also introduced our own abnormal human activity dataset. It includes the skeletal and the depth data of various abnormal activities such as fainting, headache, and chest pain. And only the publicly available datasets have fall, but this has the other more relevant abnormal activities such as fainting, headache, and chest pain. The related work that has been done in this field are by Khan et al., who introduced R trans.
So presently the buildings which we have are occupied with heating and lighting conditions and competition, which are manually driven using the resources of the buildings. But the smart buildings aims to enhance effectiveness and intervention of the systems, with enhancing the safety, productivity, and the living standards of the people who are living inside the buildings. So, smart buildings are composed of various sensors and electronic devices, which can be termed as cyber physical system. And this smart building can be used in research for communication, computation, controlling of different physical devices, and this smart building is helps in integration of different types of sensors and different types of equipment, which enhances the security, privacy, authentication, storage, and cost effectiveness of the building. The objective of our project is to integrate. First, we have what we have done is we have deployed various sensors in the building, and then we have done data collection and recognition of simple and complex events. From there, we have automated the constructed events, and we have automated the actions from these events which we have detected, and we have integrated these sensors so that we can monitor and control them, and we have constructed a structure so that it is cost effective, and it is eco-friendly, and it does not interfere with the living conditions of the people which are inside the building.
Dr. Bhadauria received PhD from IIT Indore, and she is an associate assistant professor at ABV-IIITM, Bombay. The research expertise of Dr. Soumya Bhadauria are computer organization and architecture, information security, network security, optimization techniques. Now I invite Dr. Soumya Bhadauria to take the session forward. On
behalf of all the IIITM family, I'd like to mention few points which every presenter has to consider while presenting. Each presenter has 15 to 20 minutes to present and 3 to 5 minutes for the questions. And you will be given notifications whenever your time is about to finish. And I'd like to call upon my first speaker. And the first speaker's name is Aditi Raizada. She's from Delhi Technical University. Her paper ID is 74, and the title of her paper is A High Linearity and Low Noise Shunt Resistive Feedback UWB LNA. So I'd like to call upon Aditi to come over and present.
Good afternoon. In the paper, A High Linearity and Low Noise Shunt Resistive Feedback UWB LNA. Low noise amplifier is the first stage of the receiver. Its main function is basically to increase the linearity and decrease the overall noise of the system, and to accommodate large signals without distortion. Therefore, for improving linearity and minimizing noise figure, low noise amplifier is used. I have used the frequency band range. I have used is 3.1 to 10.6 GHz, which is currently frequently very used, frequency band. It is called ultra wide band. The data rate is 500 Mbps. Its advantages is low cost. It is of low cost and low power because it is unlicensed. Its application is in various fields are in communication, wireless, personal area network, radar. In radar, it's ground penetrating radar and through wall radar, and its intelligent sensor. Its intelligent transport system, intelligent transport system, and intelligent driving aids. This is the circuit I have designed in the ADS. These two transistors are in cascode configuration so as to improve the reverse isolation. And resistive feedback is provided by this R1 resistor. And this transistor is used to increase the gain of the system. And the pi matching is used at the input using these two inductor and a capacitor. And this capacitor is used to block the DC signal. This is what I have explained earlier.
exact focus, then that is known as imperfect. Now, microsatellites among these are responsible for various diseases, so that's why we are working on this microsatellite. Now, those diseases which are related to these microsatellites are, some of these are these diseases. As we can say, this is the disease and this is the gene affected because of which this particular disease occurs, and this is the repeat pattern because of which this particular disease occurs. As we can see, the repeat pattern is, we are having pattern size of 3. So, repeat pattern is between microsatellite, 1 to 6 PSP. Here we can see the repeat pattern is 3 or 4. Here also 3. So, this is microsatellite. Now, the literature review based on these random repeats. The classic paper, the most popularly used algorithm in this area is proposed by Benson in 1990. And the algorithm given by him is known as TRF, random repeats finding. It's a computer related program which is available online. We can compare our result. Any person who does work in this area compares his result with this algorithm TRF. And these are various other algorithms. The objective form by me is based on the point that we can see all maximum algorithms are based on transforms. And another thing that I will tell my objective based on this. The objective is, many of these algorithms are based on the transform in which we are going to change our domain from time domain to frequency domain also. When we change the transform, there may be the possibility of domain bias, and because of that there may be some information. So there is a need to propose an algorithm where there is no domain transformation involved, and we have proposed. The second thing, the second objective which we have formed based on this literature review is that many
of basic samples, the network topology is in form of tree. So there could be one root node and all the other nodes will be extended from that node. So here the topology will be form of the tree. It is the basic outline of the algorithms of protocol, how this is done. So if we have a large network, so in our protocol the whole network is divided into regions, and only the regions if A is a node and B is a node, if two nodes want to communicate with one another, so only a subsection, only some regions will participate in the routing instead of the every node in the network. So in this way, we will save some energy. So the three steps, coordinate communication steps, Euclidean distance calculation, and self-region algorithm. These three stages are inherited from ERRPL, which is based of my work. So by these algorithms, we are dividing the whole network into different regions. Now, for P2P discovery, we can have, in this protocol, as I said, the network topology is a form of tree. So we can have root node also can move, and other nodes can also move. So the mobility is detected on the basis of how that node is changing its parent. So if the source node is the root node, the root node only has a child at it. So on the basis of the frequency by which the node is changing its type, we can detect the mobility. And if there is non-root node, so by how many times it is changing its parent, by this algorithm, by this logic, we can change the mobility. So for destination, if the destination is always the root node, so we require two algorithms, and for source, if the source is given, we require one algorithm. So this is just the detection of mobility, stability of the network topology. What we need to do is, if our network is in a form of tree structure, to minimize the impact of mobility, we want to we should not rely on the node which is mobile in nature, because if the node moves, the links which are associated to that node, they become invalid. So it suffers from packet loss. So what we are doing is, we are just introducing a new field, that is mobility gap, which will always introduce whenever a node is moving, it will introduce all its neighbor that I am a mobile node, so that other nodes can not exactly ignore. It will not give the priority to that mobile node, so that the life of A is mode node rather than the mobility node. So this information, whether the intermediate nodes are mobile or not, this information is given by the mobility flag in this field. So
in these two ways we are avoiding to choose the mobile nodes, and we are
by the NGSIM. The data contain information moving car for a period of 15 minutes on the highway. From the original data, the information of 201 number of vehicles is considered as 201 extracted to carry out Internet of Vehicle simulation. In the data video was slide represented in the terms of time frame, or the time interval between two consecutive frames is 5 seconds. The data taken from the NGSIM in the terms of velocity, acceleration, time, lane ID, all these things. And in this simulation, we have considered the communication range of the vehicle is 15 meters. These are the tables taken from the real data, input data. And we have designed a MATLAB program to compute these trust level. And in this figure, we can clearly see that the trust value is the 0.59. And after containing the vehicle, U is increasing, and similarly, trust is decreasing. And in the presence of misbehavior vehicle, we can see the trust value is rapidly decreasing. So we have introduced a unified trust scheme to enhance the vehicle safety in IOV. It has been found the uncertainty associated with the vehicle is high when recommending vehicle are not present or very small in the number. However, in presence of large neighborhood, the uncertainty associated with the trust of the vehicle. The notation of uncertainty confirms that change in a trust is intuitive and confirms to normal common sense behavior. Also, when we obtain a prior
reward function, but what function you have used it? You have increased and decreased the value on what function?
When people are communicating with each other, so initially they are first 0.5 is the U, 0.35 is the U, and 0.05, 0.05. And when they are communicating after some time, so uncertainty is increasing. When uncertainty increases, we are assigning the value of uncertainty. When vehicle communicate with each other or after some time, so by default when
two shares R1 and R2, after creating this, that two shares R1 and R2. We create another two shares R3 and R4, which are just R1 and R1 or operation R2 and R1 and operation R2, which is just R3 is actually the R1 or R2, and R4 is R1 and R2. That is the just binary operation, just binary operation. And step 4, we have used a session key between the sender and receivers. This TS is just 8-bit binary number. What we have done, we have just break these 8-bit numbers in two parts, first 4-bit and second 4-bit. What we have done, we have just taken two row at a time, and every 4-bit just till the
existing one. This is my number. Here is the freedom of angle, choosing of angle alpha 1 beta 1. That is being when we choose the values of alpha 1 and beta 1, then my fraction Fourier work as a filter, which is not transform the all the part of the pixel values of the image, it transforms only some part of the pixels. Same. This is my main contribution of fraction Fourier transform. Then next is the my friend's question.
Yeah. Can you just flash the slide of the criteria or method, metrics on which you have evaluated?
Just flash that slide.
Literature review for solving these problems. So these are the three issues which are faced in the basic data disaggregation of vehicular radar networks. Okay, so we are considering two scenarios, highway and urban scenarios. Okay, so this protocol DVCAS, which is a distributed vehicular broadcast protocol, it is used for highway scenario, and it solves out the problem for dense as well as sparse network. Okay, this UBCAS is solving out the problem for only urban scenario. Drive and CRAD protocol are used for solving out the problems of highway as well as urban scenarios. Okay, but as you can see that none of these protocol is solving the resynchronization effect. Okay, now another protocol ICRS is solving the broadcast wrong problem as well as the resynchronization effect. Okay, but the problem in this protocol is that in the case of urban, we have two types of road topologies. One is regular and another is irregular.
But sir, but that's not the only thing. That even I have taken an example in the end. Even complex that in the n cross n iteration, like we are actually getting, we are just using n scale computations, and for calculating one of the features in one of the paper, they are actually using 8 n scale computations. If we are making the O n of the model, it will be n scale for the board. But here there is a difference of 7 times. And scale that actually contribute a lot of reducing the complexity.
Yes, now the question is when you have, let us say, data set of medium size,
right?
Small, medium, and large,
right?
Large and large. So, this data set will be scheduled.
It will be a medium.
Medium.
It has 1400 images. I have tested on 600 for use for training, and rest of others for the test. 600 for training, and rest of it for testing. Yes. So, these were already mentioned in the previous literature itself. They have used that thing.
There should be some methodology in this. How many of the same problems for training and testing?
So, one more motivation behind this thing. I already mentioned in one of the objectives that I want to make it.
Are you using some levels?
So these are supervised bits, CNN based to supervised. This is a CNN architecture.
You have to when the relay everything is shared.
Right,
sir. This is not even data. And you are saying supervised.
Genius, the sequence cover, and I congratulate them for doing nice work. And I finally conclude the session. Thank you. Thank you.
Motivations. Today, the researchers are basically trying to focus their attention toward the most efficient techniques for enhanced man-machine interactions. And we know there are two types of man-machine interactions. One is verbal and the second is non-verbal. And facial expression is a non-verbal expression. As we know, the facial expressions are playing a crucial role in our daily life during the interaction to others. And we can we have known that there are seven basic emotions that is proposed by Professor Ekman Paul. And these basic emotions are, let me say, surprise, fear, anger, and disgust. But what about the micro expression? Basically, if we have to identify the six basic emotions, we can easily identify that is a person is the micro expression. And recognizing micro expressions are
demonstrated with the basic difference in the asymmetry in the source and drain doping that leads to a step-like energy band diagram as shown in this figure. It is essentially if we increase the gate bias, the bands in the channel move downward with an increase in the gate bias, which lead to a shortening of the tunneling barrier bridge at the source and channel junction that leads to tunneling of electrons from valence band of the source to the conduction band of the channel. And after that, by the conventional drift diffusion mechanism, the current flows through the device. This is essentially the fundamental switching mechanism of a tunnel filter, which is quite different from that of a MOSFET, which follows the Fermionic emission of electrons over the barrier that limits it to 60 millivolt per decade, that is basically the suppression swing. So the tunnel effect is independent of the thermal, the Maxwell Boltzmann tail of carrier, and hence it overcomes the fundamental limitations of MOSFET and it leads to steeper switching. So the basic difference between a tunnel FET and a MOSFET is that in a tunnel FET, the source and drain doping is asymmetric, and which is symmetric in case of MOSFET as shown in this figure, which leads to a band structure like a step-like band structure, and the inter-band-to-band tunneling takes place at the source and channel junction.
The authors have proposed for energy efficient exploration. What they have done is they have chosen the frontier cells in a manner, in a clockwise manner, left, front, then right. So that the area all to the left side must be covered, then front, then right. Otherwise, if we keep on moving it left, front, right, then something will lag here, something will lag here, we have to come again and again. So this was their idea. And for motion planning, they are using some graph-based technique. So that in that graph, they have formed the vertices and the cells. So on the cells, they have represented the amount of energy, what is taken. So in that kind of scenario, they have used that particular energy and vertices, ages and vertices to find out the path which requires the minimum energy. The cell is the energy efficient motion planning in utilizing redundant coverage. And if they are using the grid cells, then it needs to be transformed into this is a weakness. Next one is the, this one is the first paper proposed by Yamaji for frontier-based exploration. He was the one who was given the technique for frontier-based exploration method. What he has done is simply used that whatever the environment to the nearest frontier. Whatever is the nearest frontier to a robot is allocated as the next frontier cell. Lower matter is given. They mentioned minimizing the computational overhead. So their topic is to speed up the frontier detection. For that they have using the two techniques. One is the wavefront frontier detection and another is the fast frontier detection. Both of the techniques do not require the processing of entire data. They are using the new laser readings. They are not processing entire data every time. And yes, but in that case there are four kind of different frontiers. So in order to maintain or to access only the new frontiers, they have to maintain the previously detected frontier. This is requires quite a tight integration.
I'm Neha Sharma. I'm a student from IIITM Gwalior, and co-founder also Professor Aditya Kalyana. My topic is energy harvesting and information processing in cooperative multi-relaying networks. primary goal of any communication system is to make it energy efficient.
You mean it a pointer, so use pointer also.
The primary goal of any communication system is to make it energy efficient. So it is a promising approach towards energy harvesting. It not only improves the energy efficiency, but it also reduces the dependency on the battery. This approach of harvested energy in different energy harvesting devices. The energy harvesting and information processing is done by the RIDI in cooperative building networks. The motivation behind the paper is the advantages of the energy harvesting. It increases the duration of operation of energy constrained wireless networks, as well as we are dealing with a cooperative communication.
What is that? Our texture features
are visible or not? You can say that, but basically in texture features we are considering homogeneity, correlation.
Example, ADPP, that is asynchronous decentralized path planning, asynchronous decentralized device path planning, synchronized decentralized path planning, synchronized decentralized device path planning. In this, particular system is not for large scale systems because they need to provide local communication in between to find the shortest path using decentralized approach. In this, they have used rapidly exploring random tree approach. This is used for complex environment, but in this case, first question arises or weakness of this paper is how to set the priority for the robots. So I have given proposed methodology. So first of all, formal description, a path for robots can be defined joining multiple points from x0, y0 to xm, ym, where x1, y1, 2, xi, yi are intermediate points for overall path length. Next, path length, I have already discussed about this. Next one is path safety. What is path safety? Basically, path safety is the difference between obstacles and robot's position, because there may be some situation where obstacles may collide. So the path safety is the safety distance between or safety measure between robots and obstacles. This is again, if there may be path collision, then we can give maximum.
Using 11, previous equations and this equation, we can simplify the problem P2 as this one. In this, first we have a matrix variable problem, but now we have converted into a vector variable problem, which is less complex in comparison to the previous one. But still, this problem is a non-convex because of the fractional form in the objective function. So for converting into a convex form, we use fractional programming theory. And fractional programming theory states that if a problem given as minimization of n by d, where n is a numerator and d is a denominator, and n is greater than 0, d is greater than 0, then this problem can be solved using parametric programming, which is given by this equation, where alpha is a positive parameter. And the solution of this problem can be found by finding the positive zero of this problem. So we can solve. So after applying the fractional programming theory in previous problem, we simplify the problem as P4, where value of alpha
are supposed to be
ये सर एक्चुअल में ये पूरे डिजाइन है, मल्टी इंस्ट्रूमेंट
And even in this, we have also included some library, this component library. So they say, after all, suppose you are not having 7 segment in hardware, 7 segment in here, after motor, in here, relay, in here. So, what is it to virtually, मतलब real time virtual आप software पे चला रहे हो, तो ये 7 segment चल रहा है. तो ये एक demonstrator board है, इसमें FPGA में अपन ने program.
I have simulated it for a period of 8 years. During the period of 8 years with the temperature, with the room temperature, we can see there is an increase of threshold voltage up to 0 to 100 millivolts. With the increase of threshold voltage, the variation in delay, which is performance of the circuit, variation in delay of the circuit is up to a maximum of 18%, this entire circuit delay. Since we are considering only the threshold voltage increase of P-MOSFET, so I have done it individually for this particular transistor, which is a PCOS transistor. Because of this, I think there is almost no change. The reason is that the PCOS transistor only worked during the first half of the wave. In the second half of the wave, these PMOS transistor work. Right? So because of this transistor, there is no issue. Again, the keeper, this is required only for the 50% of time. This keeper is required when you are not giving any input to this transistor, your SRAMs are all zero. In that case, the pull down, this dynamic node is completely charged, it is not discharged from this place. But what happens, consider our 32 bit processor or 60 bit processor, all those processors have 64 transistors connected in cascaded or 32 transistors connected in cascade. All these transistors, they all leak. When they all leak, this node tends to discharge. So to keep the charge intact, we use this keeper. Fine, since this keeper is used only when no SRAM has a 1 in this or the SRAM is not read, this condition can happen only 50% of the time. So this PMOS is also free, the only PMOS because of which this much amount of degradation is happening is this PMOS of this inverter. So my research focused completely on this PMOS to how to reduce the S. So what I observed,
so how will you model that? 8 years you
were doing? Yes sir, yes. No, not for 8 years sir. No. Sir, there are many models of NBTI. One is a Mosera model, most reliability analysis model.
In simulation, model, you have some parameters.
Yes sir, already models are embedded into that.
So how do you put that parameter for 8 years?
Actually sir, we give a time of 8 years of operation. So it will simulate up to that much amount of time. It will not wait for 8 years.
It will do in nanoseconds.
But the effects that will come in after 8 years, that effects are included with simulation. So results are generated according to that. Of course, the Mosera model is also included by the ARM processor company. ARM processor,
if you want to run this fan, this is an AC fan, so we can connect it to AC. But some LED bulbs, these bulbs need DC power, so it can be directly connected to that also. A small example for that. So it is a combination of AC and DC buses. Now the review of literature. In the review of literature, there are several papers which I have studied, but they deal with of technologies what we are using, photovoltaic system, computing, multi-object. They deal with microgrid planning in uncertainty. What happens if grid failure takes place? What happens if load demand increases suddenly from industry and all? So another paper is sizing and analysis of a renewable energy battery system in the residential microgrid. So different paper deals in different terminologies. In this paper, they have discussed about optimization of off-grid system in other places in Canada and all. Another paper discusses about the modeling and optimization systems of hybrid renewable energy. Now, what are the research here? In terms of Indian scenario, we need to understand there is a difference in the power setup of India and power setup in abroad. So we need to calculate what is the maintenance cost of that, what is the operation cost of that, what is the pollution, emission of greenhouse gases and all. Apart from that, various combination of DC side, solar, PV.
Currently it is 5.2 million. And the main biomarkers of this disease are the shrinkage of hippocampus. Hippocampus is one of the lesions in the brain, and the change in the brain volume. Mostly when this disease happens to any person, the neurons of the brain, they get shrink. So there is a change in brain volume and alteration in the gray matter of the brain. So the motivation of my work is that if we check out the 3D brain, there are three views of the brain that are axial, sagittal and coronal. So in each view, there are different regional places where this atrophy could be seen. So like here, this is a normal image and this is an alien image. So you can see that the volume of the brain is shrinking. Like the white matter and the gray matter difference can be seen. The gray matter is shrink, so the region is less. The gray region is less in the images. So with this view, and if we see the literature work, we see there are two types of work going on. There, one is the multivariate approaches in which the whole brain, we take the whole region, that is the multivariate approaches. And these are some of the works. And other are the ROI based, like we take the only gray matter, or we take the hippocampus or the amygdala, these different regions. So as this is my initial work in my research. So I started with the whole image so that I could understand it, how this thing is working. So the as I told initially that we can see that different position of tissues are different in these different views. And if we can somehow fuse these views, so maybe we will get more information and the good results. 3D images are there. But
they're talking about MRI?
Yeah. We 3D images, but then the computational complexity will be very high. And even then the features, the feature extraction, if
so you
we
know,
take the
cost
3D,
of the MRI machine?
Yeah.
So you know, no? So if you add extra software in it, it will hardly make any difference to the cost.
Yes,
we
can
see. Ki aati hai, aur dal dena usme 10,000 ka software, hardly makes a difference to 3 or 2
but what else?
Congratulations. Then Vikas Moha.
Yes.
Yeah, good presentation.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Yeah, Bandi. Venkata.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. This is for? Me. Oh, thank you.
Wavelet-based architectures for PID is quite recent. And technology, recently they are moving into it. And then we have used multiplier-based PID.
Can you show that the wheel, one wheel block diagram? See, like one. Problem is like there's a similar one earlier, but feedback. Yeah, there's a diagram of feedback something. Yeah, here or something. See here you call the speed slash motion control. It's a bit vague, no, because it's typically motion control means particularly if it is a mobile robot, I'm continuously changing the position of the robot like in XY coordinates. So therefore my object will be to move from point A to point B, whether autonomous vehicle or a wheelchair. So I'm not concerned with the speed control. Speed control is applied typically in AC machines, DC machines, etc. No, I want to have continuous constant speed. No? So different. Whereas in a mobile robot, we don't have feedback of speed. What we have is feedback of position either from GPS coordinates or so some beacons, etc. No? For roll coordinates or accelerometer, etc. Therefore, I think you know the concept here is a bit vague. We don't control the speed of a robot. No? Like if I control the speed of my car, like a constant speed, suddenly somebody puts a brake in between, I'll have a crash. Therefore, we don't control speed. No? I don't control speed at any point. I don't know what it's going to be, whether it's uphill or downhill, etc. So therefore, what you should do is that from velocity control, you should go to position control. So that is the right way to do.
But
motion control is a very big. Okay, and also maybe one more thing is, what are the sensors they use, what is the CPU, all those things you can give in the form of a table. It's a good thing that you have done like hardware, no? Because many of the papers I've seen, no? So my advice being a robotics person would be that if we can do theory plus simulation plus hardware, your paper will be the strongest. Like many times like I get papers from transactions, IEEE transaction, non-industrial electronics, etc. If there is no sim experimental implementation, I always tell. Ram Kishan Deva.
Thank you. Best.
Mr. Ashutosh Barat. The last one.
This one is the ultrasonic sensor that measures the distance.
the motion of this double acting accelerator is more like a digital circuit, which consists of on and off circuit. So in order to provide a control system, traditionally they were using RC servo valves that were very costly. So what we did was we designed RC servos using 3D printers that cost.
Dr. Sunil Yadav as a session chair for this technical session. He is currently serving as an assistant professor at IIIT Allahabad. The area of research of interest of Dr. Sunil Yadav are wireless relaying technique, cooperative communication, cognitive relaying network, device-to-device communication, signal processing, physical layer security, and MIMO system. Now I invite Dr. Sunil Yadav to take the session forward.
Detection using wireless sensor network, and the presenter is
Nitish
Khandola. Okay, on the behalf of Vivek Kumar. The second presentation will be the connectivity analysis in vehicular communication for safe transportation system, and the speaker is Dr. Ranjit Singh Thomas. The third presentation will be dual band node wide slot UWB antenna for low cost RFID applications, and the speaker is Anuma Ghosh.
These are the authors of this paper, Chasing Detection Using Wireless Sensor Network, Mr. Vivek Kumar Singh, Professor Shekhar Verma, and Dr. Manish Kumar. I am presenting this paper on behalf of co-author Professor Shekhar Verma, as he has to leave yesterday due to an urgent work. First of all, the motivation of this paper is that this is based on a documentary. It says that in earlier times, the economy of Japan is heavily based on the sea species. But in earlier times, what happens that jellyfishes used to migrate from South Korea towards Japan. I would like to tell about it over a period of 40 years. So it hardly degrade the economy. But recently, due to global warming, the frequency has increased vastly. So this series,
and from this UFO network, we use the phase ranking algorithm to identify the top influencers from this UFO network. And we use the different approaches, different clustering algorithms to identify. Means this approach is to determine which algorithm is working better for different type of data sets. Means we have categorized the Twitter data set into different size, small, medium, and large. So the small data small category includes 10,000 data sets, instances, and the medium includes between 10,000 to 1 lakh instances, and the large category includes more than 1 lakh instances. And from after categorizing this editors, we recommend which we are doing good tweets or posts, whom we can follow. So data selection includes connecting to the Twitter API, then we create UGO network for this user. So the UGO network is basically a graph in which there is a person which is known as UGO, and rest of them are editors. Means a person, then his followers, and rest of his followers. So, and for the pre-processing step, we are converting this UGO network into adjacency matrix. And to identify the top influencer, what we are doing is we are taking a transpose of adjacency matrix to get the Markov and transition matrix. After identifying, we have got this cluster of network of elders and UGOs. Then we are identifying the clusters, and we are categorizing them according to their interest using different clustering algorithms.
30 FPS is of the 30 frames per second is considered as a good streaming experience for the users. So we are trying to maintain that 30 FPS so that with cloud gaming, even with the latency, we can provide that. So these are the alternative design which are adopted for cloud gaming. So this all has been included in my research work also. So coming to the research work, which this is the overall cloud gaming architecture. So what happens, this is the my client and this is my server. So what happens, we have a command receiver, whatever joystick, keyboards, everything which has been will be here. Now these are all sent via internet file, and which this is the network or the medium which we are sending to the servers. Now the earlier what happens without cloud gaming, in the same server all the things used to be done here. So all the resources which these are using will be our system only. Now we are transferring all this all this logic, game logic and everything to the server. So we don't use our resources, we are using server's resources. So we don't have, then this dot move is went to the server, it will process the logic, then it will send you the backup video of like your chess as you move. So this is one thing. Thing is pressed here, this is processed in the servers. So this is a in general gaming module. While starting my research, I did some of the experiments, basic experiments. So then I used my VMware and used the benchmark for gaming benchmark. I have tried to solve, see what are the basics without any algorithm, without any mechanism.
The network is two sub network. Now for as an objective function, they have used the model ID. So when a network is divided into two sub network, so they have selected two sub network in such a way which maximizes the model ID score. The second one is the info map actually based on a concept map equation. What is map equation? When a random walker start walking in a network, that walker going to stay longer in a community, because in community we are having the denser region, and so that path can be compressed. A random walker going to stay longer in a community, and same node will be visited again and again. So in that manner, that path length can be compressed, and that path length can actually be represented as the map equation. So here this algorithm try to decrease this value. Okay, they are trying to find out the community which will provide the maximum decrease in this map, the local neighborhood, by mixing with which node we will get the maximum modular value. So in that case, in first step, the local maxima is found by the algorithm. Once that part is done, in next step, all the nodes which are merged in the first phase, those nodes are considered as a new node, and then the same process is applied until we get increase in the modularity value. This one is the fourth one, label propagation. This algorithm works in a manner every node will be assigned a unique label, and every node then try to label them a tie. So this tie is broken randomly. So in that case, we will opt A. Now C is having two neighbors, both neighbors are having label A. So C also relabel itself. The propagation algorithm works. Fast greedy, this is the enhancement of the original greedy algorithm.
Direct, there is no relation between that choosing Q for these values or R as this value, we can get a minimum right step. So we have used some intelligent techniques for finding the optimization, for finding the optimal things for Q and R matrices. So the rotary inverted pendulum, this is the rotary inverted pendulum. So here a servo motor is connected to which the pendulum arm is connected, and on the pendulum arm the pendulum is rotating, really connected. So it's quite something like that we have a motor here which rotates the arm. On the arm there is a pendulum, so it is leading and so there are two stable points for it. One is the stable point or this is the stable point. So our aim is to stabilize it in the upright position, theta, and the angle which results with this is the alpha.
So the linearest state space model, we are embedded on the linearest state space model, which will be taken from the parameters of a the concept based rotary inverted pendulum that is present in our lab. So we have four states here. Third is equal to AX plus BU, where U input is my motor voltage and my output. The A matrix, when we have done the analysis for the eigenvalues of the A matrix, we have found that the two of the eigenvalues are negative, but one is at origin, that is 0, and one lies
connection or infrastructure to vehicle communications. It is a major important component of intelligent transportation system, because nowadays the every developed countries will try to focus to implement the intelligent transportation systems. In intelligent transportation systems, the nodes are basically follow the DSRC protocol, this dedicated short range communication protocol, and it will recommend to the IEEE 802.11b protocols.
This identification would be something like identifying a particular person out of a crowd of, let's say, 100 people. Verification is something, as the name suggests, verifying the identity of a particular user. So, like the popular applications of person recognition ranges from security and surveillance systems to mostly access control. Other of these are take authorization problems and security and surveillance system. So, for example, if we need to identify people. On the other hand, similarly with tagging pictures, but unlocking your phone, that is an example of verification, right? And with the advent of such systems to actually verify the identity of the user, so that we can give the user the context pertaining to that particular user. Now,
using a very basic concept of big data and the generic algorithm model. So firstly, come up with this and my co-author is Yevanita Kasturi. She is also here. She is also coming from Multiple IT Lab. She is also an assistant professor. And we both have developed this paper. So we are going to discuss on the expansion of the social connectivity. And it is a concept of big data analysis and the general overview of my work, what I wanted to do. The basic idea what was into our focus was that is to expansion of the collaboration done in the social network. That was our main idea. So in the social networking, what happens, there is a huge data transfer and intercommunication takes place. So for that interrelation or the so in ResearchGate, what we can see, there are a huge number of researchers who are working in different fields, in different areas, and they are sharing. Researchers' position in the research world is usually analyzed by the RG score, citations, H indexes, the number of articles they have published, the follower and the followers. So keeping all these attributes into mind,
variables, but there were people who are able to decipher the information from that nutrition label. So they found the nutrition labels confusing and very hard to understand. And similarly, in this paper from Margareta Vandel, food labels are viewed as important source of information to consumers. They have, in this research paper, they have concluded that their consumers have difficulties trying to understand this information. And the terminology and the food labels appear to be very technical for the common man. So the people who read these food labels dealt with this in different ways. They either didn't use it at all or they used the labels to a limited extent. So, Vajpayee-Indian all proposed a model which provides, which shows how much factors such as nutrition knowledge and dietary awareness have a direct influence on the HEI. So, and from the literature survey, we can see that there is no paper of this which can relate this nutritional analysis with supervised learning approach. So, the methodology for this project, there are five major modules in this project: labeling, classification, and then find the accuracy prediction. The data retrieval, we've scraped websites, since there weren't really any websites from India which contain this nutritional source, we went for 10.
The input impedance is highly deviated from 50 ohm. As a result of which, what will happen if the, now we know that for maximum power to happen, there will be very high amount of reflection from the input. That means if I connect an SMA collector over here, SMA collector is 50 ohm collector. Now if the input impedance of this antenna is highly deviated from 50 ohm, then what will happen? Then there will be high reflection of electromagnetic waves from here, as a result of which standing waves will be generated, and as we have seen, due to the high generation of standing waves, the voltage standing wave ratio is going very high, I mean higher than 2 at the 2 frequency. Now if I come to the imaginary part, now for any RLC circuit, now when the antenna will be resonating from my frequency part, then it is assumed that within the entire frequency range it should be at the close vicinity of 0. But see, at this frequency, so what is happening over here, at these 2 notch frequencies, if it is very highly deviated from 0, that means there is a part of imaginary impedance that is coming into effect. And if imaginary impedance comes into effect, then radiation of energy. And L, inductor stores magnetic energy, and the capacitor stores electric energy. Then I can say that this is storage of energy instead of radiation of energy, as a result of which the notches are created. So these are the two perspectives.
Changes are in the your ACG signal, and based on that we are going to develop a technique so that we can detect bundle branch block and normal. Bundle branch block is a connection rod in the block in the left or right ventricle of the, and based on the location it can be classified in two parts, left bundle branch block or right bundle branch block. So these since they represent the ventricle depolarization, they will affect the QRS complex of the heart. So variation will be reflected in those parts of the ECG. For the database, we have used the MIT
verified data becomes static. Solution is that non-parametric inductor function makes the prediction based on subset of the samples sparse connectivity. Manifold regularization is scaled by solving the dual optimization problem of manifold regularization subject to sparsity constraint. Parallel graph replication of large data set using map reduced distribution and distributed computing framework on.
Belongs to the vertices, and WI correspond to the distances between XI and XJ. And E is the summation of this W.
At order, SSL models use available data as the time required is very high. In sequential processing, the available resources, all vertices quickly and correctly by parallel model creation using MapReduce.
Consider wireless and using another application. So we are like microsystem where why is this is received symbol, vector in this case, so this is a MIMO. H is a general matrix, X being the input symbol, and N is the relative weight Gaussian noise. This is also a vector. Here we have considered NR being the number of received symbols, so basically we have N, NR, NR antennas, and it is the transmitted vector from the transmitter. And H being a matrix, which is HIJ is each element of the channel, where it is assumed again to be 0 median, median 1. Same thing for the noise as well. Single type channel we have used, which is again very commonly used in microarchitecture. Now, so basically here, X is a vector of only the real part, of the constellation. Similarly for edge and y in or for the substrate you see the dimension of the thing. So here and for channel is 2 and nr cross and t. So nr is for the receiving terminals and t is for the transmitter. So my mode detection number 3 basically you have y what you have received, x is what you are trying to estimate.
We have performed our test on 3 to 25 second videos, and that is the S image that we get. It is an RGB. We saw it with R, which we had got after performing the CRT. Then mask is prepared. Now these are some stills from the video that we had encrypted. The secret, there is no loss of any kind quality in this because we are now, this is the correlation between the actual image, the actual frames and the decrypted frames, and also the correlation between the actual and the decrypted frames is 1 because they are exactly same because of the zone. And the correlation value is tending to 0. There is original frame and the decrypted frame. And this is the computational according to the number of frames which we are having in the video. This is the
Dr. Ranji. Ms. Sham.
The new platform, like this is our IoT, it's trying to develop IoT platform. So it will form that this IoT platform and this type of nodes. So multiple nodes based on different type of different type of size. We are providing number of nodes and number of sensors and all this. So, we are coordinating
this is your board or?
No, this is ZP.
No, ZP is the bottom.
Yeah, bottom one is ours. This is the worst. We have provided.
Here it goes to there.
No, from there.
The other one.
Transmitting from here to here.
Yes, sir.
So, we have multiple range of products for education, like test and measurement instruments, and then this technology, 3G, then IoT. For more than 50 types of analog data sensors, student can study and can build applications based on this sensors. So, all this is, we have provided all this data. Suppose,
start.
Presently this IR sensor is here. So this said multiple temperature sensors, light sensors, pressure sensors, environmental sensors, sensor speed sensors. So multiple types of sensors we have put inside this, and student can analyze and after required for this like F2V converter, everything we have provided on board. So that user can
isolate.
This is 3G development platform. So in this we have equipment, so user can do run projects, water terminals, and also build using Android
programming.
What is the main point of the test? So, we have less. 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 We have less
एनालिसिस उसके बाद कंट्रोल. तो फर्स्ट पार्ट हो गया हमारे जैसे वायरलेस सेंसर अपना क्लाउड में डाल दिया, तो क्लाउड में हमने स्मार्ट हेड डाल दी कि कितने लेवल पर इसको कंट्रोल करना. फिर उसके बाद सेकेंड वे में जो बाइडायरेक्शनल टेलीमेट्री आती है उससे वो आप अपना डाटा क्लस्टर कर सकते हैं. उसके साथ जैसे अपनी कम्युनिकेशन में जहाँ पर लोग रिसर्च करते हैं जैसे अपना सॉफ्टवेयर डिफेंड रेडी हो गया, तो उन सब में अपनी वी एल एस आई से प्रोग्रामिंग करना, आप लोग लाइब्रेरी से करना है, तो लाइब्रेरी नेक्स्ट प्लेटफॉर्म पर अगर आप लोग करना है
system must support. And after, in the last iterations, you can see that the number of pairs are going to be available in very less number. And unless in the last iteration, there will be no pair down. There will be all the pairs available in the solution. So in this way, we can say that the algorithm, when the iteration goes on, the exploration is decreasing and the exploitation is increasing. Now we have compared our algorithms, the four existing benchmark algorithms, PSO, ABC, GSA, gravitational search algorithm, and there's a recent one, Ray Wolf popularity. These are the unique parameters of the functions. We have compared these algorithms. First is the unimodal functions. These functions, what we can get from the performance efficiency phenomena of the algorithm. It means if your algorithm is doing work in those solutions, because these are easy solutions.
All over present. So we have used MSRFB, ASD, which has generally been used in last few papers, which has been accepted. So we have trained the, we have checked all the data on these six data sets, and the results that we have obtained is, so first is qualitative evaluation. We have taken paper in the past. So what they have done is they have differentiated based on these models. They have detected the selling of the company's model in these ways, and our proposed model has detected. For the quantitative evaluation, the comparison has been made on the basis of four parameters, precision, recall. This the various models have been compared, and it has been observed that among the all, but it has been performing the second least based on the timing. The best timing is in the image. Now the what the result? We have obtained the highest
decision making. Then it becomes spatial classification. Modeling spatial information, it is one of the major challenge in the spatial data mining. And this neighborhood system is one of the technique to incorporate spatial information. So here are four neighborhoods, 4x4 neighborhood and 5x4 neighborhood. In this system, we only we only consider four neighborhood object of X, and other objects will not be considered. Decision tree induction is a supervised technique for learning. And
forward, the problem is there is a degradation for a cell edge. So if you I consider two scenarios where I have a base station and multiple users. So I have two base stations, and then there is a small handset, which is a UE, and these are two base stations. So if the user is somewhere closer to the edge, it gets affected by the interference from the system adjoining. When closer to the base station, then we don't see the problem, because that's how actually the planning is done as well. The same time frequency are not used. This is the intercell interference, and there's an intracell interference from the different users in the same, especially.
People are searching their problems, day-to-day problems on the world. They post some queries related to their problem, health-related problems, to a public forum or online consultations. Many online consultations are there. Some examples I have put some examples there. And expect answers from the experts. So two types of services are there: online consultation services, a paid service and unpaid service. In case of paid service, usually a webmaster reads the query posted by the user and assigns the query to the appropriate doctor, related to the doctor. And in case of he answers the query. Next, see what is the problem when reading the query. User usually third query and or unstructured text query. In case of a structured, they get to fill the name, age, sex, symptom, problems, the medicine. But users usually follow write the preform text in which they write the query in the
17, it is 11 exabyte. So this is a prediction by the Cisco that it will be 49 exabyte in 2031, and it is increasing exponentially at the average rate of 47% CAGR. It is a compound annual growth rate of data traffic. So what we understand here, huge data will create a problem. We have limited bandwidth. So manage the devices, which is present or will be in future, to provide the services. So traffic offloading will be a critical challenge for us. So,
So here is the solution, device to device communication. Goes to base station, then from base station it connects to receiver. And in this way, that base station controls the transmitter and receiver, and into.
So this is the work proposed by Ackman, and he used 46 action units all across the phase, and he derived that the anger, disgust, fear, joy, sadness, and surprise. So here you can see what is the features that are changing a lot. Means when a person is in anger, in disgust, and joy, or sadness, or surprise. So oral part is showing a great variance. Means when you are in anger, you have some another this, you have some another distraction. So this motivated us to do some exploitation in this area.
Data. So that's why he has some limitations. For example, earlier an optical fiber had one core and cladding. So that one core consists a maximum capacity of 100 gigabits per second. But we can just enhance this capacity by using more number of cores. So we can just say that a multiple fiber is a kind of optical fiber which contains more than one number of cores in the same cladding region. Here we are using a 7 cores in that same cladding region. Earlier it was a conventional core, it was containing only this one. But here we have the number of estimate this cost of and how we reduce the cost of. And to during this analysis, we have to fiber parameters like bending, fiber bending, and all these things where the cladding diameter and the cladding thickness is most important thing, because the cladding cannot take as much as high, and the cladding thickness is used to energy indexing, which retrieve right information or more approximate right information related to the block D is very much interesting. So that's the scope we have to utilize, and that's the way we have gone in this work. So let me go to the straight away how the till now different other techniques are used in the recommendations of log, because the recommendation is already coming from long journey, particularly for blocks. There are the techniques which are used in the blocking recommendation. This is a relationship where the threading is coming up from one block to another block, and there the block is recommended. Another way is a particular block, for example, the title or the image or the images. Based on that, the block is recommended. And another method is also used, that is computing the score, providing the weight a particular in a particular hub of the blocks. In these,
now the point is, just I'm just trying for my own information. How do you launch laser light in these multi cores?
Sir, these are the techniques because of cladding diameter is it's coming in terms of micrometer, 125 or 200 micrometer.
That's right.
We have without such type of experiment. Equipments in my college.
No, not in your college. I'm just
nice question. Sir, actually, in that one, launching a core in a single core is having some equipments or something. But in the 7 core, we have to use before that is a fan in and fan out technique, where these 7 core has been individually separated and launch the power in each core, and that is get in the part that is called the fan in and combined, and it will be finally given to that all the. Finally,
you have the tapers with you, okay, and through taper you connect,
okay.
But in this case, I am not able to comprehend whether it's a special free space connection or it's a tapered connection or multiple tapered connections are there.
Yes, because technology,
just because the G is fair enough, very good, very high capacity will be there in these fibers.
Yes, multiple tapered connection you are there. That is the thing I'm just saying, that is a fan-in and fan-out technique. Because you can
multiple tapers.
Yeah, you can use the multiple tapers.
High technology.
So I'm sure about this. Within this 10 and 15 years, this technology has come because of demand of high trafficking and
no,
all this.
No, high, fair enough, very high trafficking.
Basically, it depends on the material. Suppose that I'm choosing the silica, SiO2, it has nearly 1.33 in the practical, but due to some chemical composition added, it will come to the 1.45. So, and if a little bit variation by using some chemical composition, it can be set at that 1.45 having a cladding refractometer and including chemical in that SiO2, it will give 1.4551. So, we can through this, we can just fabricate this core and cladding with having particular refractive indexes.
No, but there must be some core or refractiveness must be higher than that of that.
Yeah, always.
Right.
In the optical fiber.
So, in your case, that is around 0.05, I
yes,
think.
Sir.
It is just a difference between the two.
Yes, sir.
Right? So, what would it affect on the total internal refraction kind of things?
Sir, basically, this difference between this is delta 1 cannot be less than 0.3% because it will create one kind of linear polarization defect. But in optical fiber, we do not propagate TE and TM modes. We propagate linear polarization modes because TE and TM modes, they degenerated and form linear polarization mode. If the percentage delta 1 is less than 2%, then weakly guided mode propagate, that is the linear LP modes propagate. But if you take delta 1 value more than 2%, suppose that cladding is 1.45 and the core having 1.48, then definitely it will be nearly 2.5%. So in that case, you can propagate your TE and TM modes. But in optical fiber for enhancement of mode, we have to go in the linear polarization mode because this in optical fiber, this linear polarization mode analysis is more better as more better and more accurate as to the TE and TM mode analysis. Because this TE and TM mode get combined and it will propagate and it will act as an LP mode.
So you are doing theoretical, I think. Actually,
my work is basically theoretical and second thing is mathematical. Because in the experimental result, we have some cost of near about something value, theoretical something value, but we are trying to achieve, overcome this gap between this experimental and the, because at every segment, at every divide this fiber into discrete parts and studying on this so that this error can be reduced theoretically or through the mathematical. Because after the fabrication, maybe with a little bit variation can create a lot of changes. So,
this the FEM you are using, finite
yes,
element and MATLAB, I think both things are using.
Both,
okay. Okay, so later on we will discuss. Thank you.
Hi.
Yeah. Well done.
Well.
Yes.
Thank you. Communication between the agents is not appropriate, but we are finding the gap in those trainers. So by adding some genus guidance, in appropriate manner with proper acceleration coefficients, new grade of
first
exposure we are able to find. So we are getting good values in complexity is going up slightly because see, if we modify existing framework, then we add something. And we have done the comparison time analysis. We can say it's increased by 90%. Not that much. In another bug that we are trying to find out the appropriate thresholds for dividing, for segmenting the interesting objects out of images.
You are making it a
quaternary.
So what is the performance?
The performance is
and without that, it was 96.6%. Even if it's 0.5, then also we are considering it to be a possibility that you will have instead of having a
We first get the image, that is the first phase. So we have already checked on the batch bar images. Now the second phase, we are trying to get the training thing into intervision. Because first is the unsupervised thing. So we are trying to supervise them according to the universe. Suppose we are going to classify the thing for a particular class. So first we train the method for those particular
and in which what we have innovated two new cluster operators, then in So what was the main gap in the literature was that nowadays many papers have been published in the same year. But one thing was that most of them have focused only on empirical analysis. As I have mentioned in few of the papers put in data sets and they have arrived at a conclusion. So there is one no freelance term which states that there has been no optimization algorithm. Pardon me. Which proves to be perfect in all optimization scenarios. One might outperform the others in one particular case, whereas another might have outperformed it in some other case. So this particular mathematical analysis has been lagging. So what we have done is prepared two new crossover operators, then meticulous analysis of various cases that have been, that could occur by dealing with those operators. And then we have done one more thing. We have also analyzed the fact credit count on the behavior of GA. And this particular thing, mathematical analysis for these four cases are actually related to a different types of schema problems which exist in the
field. What is the validation scheme kind of thing? How do you validate this?
Sir,
my problem is for resolution and recognition of low resolution face images. The recognition of face images is a traditional approach, but the traditional approach performs a degrade significantly when you are encountered with low resolution images. That is the case in most of the surveillance applications. Like this, we have taken this from the video. My original photo, I created it as a scale image. Then problem is that the dimension of and quality of this image is very low. We cannot make this low with the same resolution approach by which we can increase the quality, dimension and resolution of the test image. Second approach, we can reduce the dimension of quality of gallery images to match these probe and training or gallery images. Third approach is the formalization. So basically, these two approaches, first one is super resolution approach and second one is the common space approach. These two approaches are getting much attention in recent years because this approach failed because in the case of whenever we degrade down sample or reduce the dimension or scale of the gallery images, we lost the features. So, so with the minimum feature, we cannot get maximum accuracy. Basically, this is the two fields where the most of the research are going. So, firstly, I am taking this as our objective. So, to deal with super resolution approach, there are three basically approach: reconstruction rate method, dictionary rate method, and interpolation. In the reconstruction rate method, these are the basically problem. These are the basically methods that are applied on the video images, where we have a facility to capture n number of frames for single object. But the drawback of this approach is that this approach cannot be applied where we have only one scene of particular object. So for getting the maximum outcome from this type of methods, we should have a number of training, number of frames of same object. For example, we want to read the text that are written on the truck body. So truck is moving on the road, we can capture the multiple frame of the track and from some input, some knowledge or some features gained from one frame, second frame, third frame, on the basis of that we will...
More information is collected from multiple.
Second one is the interpolation rate method. Interpolation is a basic technique in which we can predict or we can generate the value of two or more points between the two discrete set of points. So basically in the interpolation rate method, this is
this
and
has
basis of some correlation we have computed before, you want to put it there and push it there.
Interpolation helps in increase the dimension. But suppose 4 and 5 is already corrupted. In suppose 4 and the original pixel value is taken from the input image. That is already corrupted. So we cannot expect some good result from the resultant image in the case of interpolation based method. Third one is the dictionary based method. In this method, the target image is generated from the help of test image as well as some training images.
Training images?
Training images, in our cases, we are using the standard databases as a training. Publicly available databases as a training images.
Are you talking about eigenfaces or something like that or something different?
Something different. So here, basically, two approaches that are global phase width and local phase width. In the global phase width method, each image globally treated, each phase is globally treated, and patch weight method is divided into patches. So patch weight is from the training images to generate the target training, target resultant HR patch, high resolution patch. And then finally merge all the patches to generate the final patch. So this is the most popular method nowadays. So this is the methodology. In
what is your contribution you are thinking about in this?
I have just finished my comprehensive in the last.
That's fine, but some ideas you would have formed by this time.
Now you said this dictionary
is
so what is the difference? And how it is going to correlate with your PhD work? That you
can. Yes, sir.
Some ideas you might have formed by now.
Yeah, this I'm working on the noise robust methods. In the noise robust method, basically the input patch. Input patch is corrupted. So from the corrupted patch, we cannot select the appropriate from the training images. For this purpose, this is the model which I am working. In the input patch, we are represented as a
link of the weights.
Yes.
That is the
okay.
That is
considered.
How to
find
the link of the weights? That is what we consider.
That's what is considered.
Yes.
There is a problem.
Yes. Then same weight will be utilized to generate the target HR patch.
This is the LR images and counterpart HR images used to generate. High level context. So, high level context, some of the different low level context that will be going to merge together and then we process the data from collected from different sensors and we come up to a high level context. So, what is the problem in current scenarios? All the high level context processors and sensors are centralized. Means we have to offload all the data from end of the sensor network to the gateway. That can be brought up energy and the inverse high-end to end. So for the time critical application, we are proposing a global network processing mechanism where we are gathering all the sensor data inside the network and processing it for ensuring high-level context and directly providing high-level context to the application.
So in the network processing or outside?
Inside the network.
Inside the network processing.
So it is beneficial in terms of energy consumption and also it will provide the data in less end-to-end delay. So the first objective is this and the second is
qualify your query, save the energy.
Yes,
so if you start processing the data within the node itself, it may start consuming more energy.
No, sir, actually, my orientation is when the transmission of the data, because we are sending the data from node to the gateway. That may consider that may include more number of hops, and it will get more energy consumed throughout the route. So to minimize that, we are just not sending data from network to the gateway. That
what I am saying that once you start processing the information within the network itself, then some networks have to have a super energy or something like that with them. Otherwise, their energy will keep on depleting. So somehow we have to take care of some way. Some way one has to. Either you designate certain nodes that it comes there and then I process it there itself, and nowhere else.
What you are doing, satisfy, you are becoming energy efficient. That means you are saving energy somewhere, right? Transmitting data from the node to the gateway. You are not doing that directly. You are doing it some other method.
I am identifying nodes inside the network dynamically, which are able to infer the high level context. That is the iterative process. Is for every query, there will be a different node where the data will be collaborated. and I'm identifying it through the global centrality, which is the graph theory approach. Based on that, I am identifying the
role of context. What is role of context here in this?
So role of context in the sense, for an application, generally the sensor, wireless sensor network sends the raw information, means raw data. And if an application is not interested in the raw data, means we are not interested in getting 39 degrees Celsius, we want more concise information. What does it mean 39 degrees Celsius based on the different application? Then it is where it comes to context. I'm sending 39 degrees Celsius like it is a low temperature or the high temperature. So I'm sending a concise information. So I need to process that data based on different criteria of the application. Means for a fire detection application, I'm not sending the temperature, humidity and smoke value, means in the raw form. I'm sending complete information that yes, there is a fire or not after processing all the data coming from different sensors.
Fine. So the main weakness of this traffic is it's easily detected and it is more costly because it involves large amount of attack, like this spoofing data. So the focus is to detect the spoofing DDoS attack technique. So the DDoS attack difference between them is we can categorize based on the deployment location or based on the deployment location, it is bounded. Means with the help of the coordination of routers, we are detecting the attack. Second one is host based, means we are deploying at either the host side or at the victim side. And the next is hybrid, means we are completing a combination, taking the help of different routers, or we are deploying either at the router side or at the host victim side. Based on the types, it is fixed event or submarine. Attacks have the same IP address, and so random spoofing attacker randomly generates an IP address to spoof the attack. In subnet spoofing, attacker is having a large number of IP address available in the subnet. So the focus is to detect, mitigate, and trace various IP spoofing attacks so that the overall impact on the attack so that the future attack can be prevented. So for obtaining these objectives, what are you doing? Capturing the network traffic.
Suppose you found identification in a way. Now this can be used in future attacks.
Yes, sir.
Use can be used.
Once an attack is detected, that IP address identity added to the filtering loop, the wiretap filtering loop. So next to that, the traffic is coming from that IP address only, it will be easily filtered. Yes. Means what we did. Next, I'm telling you the traffic was shaking.
What I am saying is, it's an adaptive gateway, meaning thereby you can designate any peripheral node as a gateway, or we bring that up.
Manet is connected to some external network through some specific node that is called the gateways. These gateway nodes provide the internet connectivity. My topic is basically based on adaptive gateway discovery, in which this is a methodology in which there are four
algorithm for this purpose.
Yes, for adaptive algorithm for source. It is our approach, and there are these four modes, that is M1, M2, M7. These three nodes come with reference range.
How big is your, how many nodes are there in
the
network? In the 5
whatever your nodes are. Approaches, and the coverage of our proposed approach is greater than many nodes. Every source coverage.
Are we assuming here that your gateway are already coming up or?
And various internet applications, like sensing cars are entering into the network. So we are identifying. QoS attributes are different here. That's the data initially, and QoS attributes are identifying information accuracy. These are the broad objectives of our project. First of all, we are satisfying the data acquisition rate, the spatial accuracy from where the data is required, and the temporal accuracy under what guideline the data is required. So, actually, the current research, the state of the art focus on only the quality aspect. Don't consider the spatial and the temporal accuracy. So we are here, our objective is to design an outline detection algorithm, in-network outline detection algorithm, that maintains the trade-off between the application QoS requirement and network resources. And the network layer parameter, network lifetime we are considering. And one information product can have various user contexts. So we are
looked at the scalability part of it here.
Yes. Actually, so we are all the mechanisms which we are designing are distributed. So we have tested our mechanism for 100 nodes, 200 nodes, up to 1000 nodes. And there can be many multiple.
So algorithm is distributed algorithm running at each and every place. Okay.
Yes. And there can be multiple gateways because in the real time scenario there will be multiple gateways. So the mechanism developed are distributed in terms of they will be running. The one part of the algorithm will be running on one gateway and another gateway, which is connected to the wireless access network.
What are QoS here?
Robots are
more
suitable than humans for the application of search and rescue operations. Explosive localization and more important than so the problem is like the search program aimed that there must be a reasonable amount of time or enough minimum amount of time. So what are the related and they send their data in multi-hop manner.